yourself to your heart, you will realize you are the most single person, the most. You don't even deserve maybe to sing this. So that's just understanding and being real to yourself. Be real and just know. And then you might even be able to find the answer. Doubts come, you might trust God for something that is not true. But don't chambua your heart, chambua your life. Sit down with God and just, and then from there you can pick up the answers. Step by
step.
I will say something because I'm one of the people who are saying it's not hard.
Uh-huh.
And I just want to say why I'm saying it's not hard because my personal testimony, I was saved when I was like, I was younger than 9 and had this really great experience with God and planned out our life and everything was fantastic. At 21, 23, I think, something happened. It was really excited. You know what? Jesus, I am no longer a Christian. Me and you were good, and I'm no longer a Christian. And he came back for me, and in his coming back for me, he showed me himself, I guess, the part of him that I wasn't seeing before. Before, in my salvation, it was all about law, law, law. Being a Christian is do. If you're not doing, you're not being a Christian. And I was very judgmental as a result, and even that made me judge myself. So for me, Christianity was about, am I doing the right thing all the time? Oh, I see. I'm no longer a Christian. This is really exhausting. And oh no, it was a really hard time. But when I came back, when he came back for me and taught me about grace, one of the things that I've learned completely that has made being a Christian easy, not that there are not hard things in Christianity, but what has made it easy for me is because I know I don't have anything to do with it. It's not by power nor by might, it's by the Spirit. So as long as every situation that I have, I take it to him. Everything I run through him, everything I depend on him, which means I'm not working on my salvation by myself. God is actually the one who's helping me through every step. I fall. When I fall, I don't sit there thinking, I'm no longer a Christian, I'm so bad. No, I take it to the Father and I say, Lord, I've fallen. And I know that this situation you're going to use is to get me to a higher level. So why I'm saying it's easy, it's not because, easy things, my life is so easy. No, it's because I've learned that it's not about me. I'm not a human doing, as Joyce Meyer says, I'm a human being. And God is the one who is working everything out in me. As long as I depend on him, he works things out. As soon as I start depending on myself, things get stressful, things get hard, things get difficult. I hope I'm communicating to somebody and I'm hoping I'm communicating. But because I don't depend on myself anymore, and I depend on him completely, it's easy. Not that things are not hard, but it's easy.
So, thank you, Koi. I really like this conversation. I think that's key.
Yeah, I think everybody has my good points. For me, the basics are two things. Love, let me start with love. Because the word says, love covers a multitude of sin. Everybody says that. Now, we can, and we already know we are filthy rags. Our righteousness is filthy rags, sorry. Okay, now if those good things are filthy rags, no, without those good things, what are you? You're nasty. So, yeah, recognizing that you are born of nastiness, with all your works and without the works, it doesn't add, it doesn't remove. And God's love covers a multitude of sin. That's where you can find, today you've sinned, according to yourself, you've really done something bad. Then you read the Bible, and the verse he sends you to is one so amazing, and talking about his love, and he shares you with his mercy, and you're like, why? Why are you still loving on me and I did something bad? It should show you that his love will never fail, regardless of what you do. That's why I think it's never been easy and it's never been hard, because his standards have never changed, and human beings have always been the same. Since Adam fell, there's nothing new to God, nothing. This generation was already predestined before we arrived here. He knew when he died for us, his grace would be sufficient for 2017. That's why we're not under the law and we're under the grace. Because the lifestyle we are living now cannot accommodate the law. Technology, innovation, the wisdom we've been given, according to the word in the Old Testament, that in Daniel, that in the end of days he shall open doors to wisdom. So all he knows all that. That's why he's given us manifold grace. That's why we are in a dispensation of grace and not of law. But with that being said, even though his love covers a multitude of sin, he gives us his grace to work out our own salvation so we can live like him. It's very hard to try and imitate him on a daily in our own sense. It's impossible. Completely impossible. He's the only blameless person who has ever lived and should ever live. And we always need to remember that. Only Jesus was sinless. Nobody will ever be like him again. But with that being said, we need to still work out our own salvation with an intentional sin. For me, sinning intentionally is the opposite of working out our own salvation. An intentional sin are things we don't know that are sinful, but still happen. Because of that, we need to repent. So there's a daily cycle. Every day is a cycle of repentance and working out your own salvation. If you stop that cycle, you have nothing. Really, you're finished. Every day is like the clock winds to the beginning. That's how I see it. Every day is a new day. And there are so many possibilities and eventualities as per what you do that day. So for me, salvation is every single day. Yesterday was yesterday. Himesha. Today is today. What can we do today? One day at a time. That's how I do with it. You know that song, one day at a time, see Jesus. Me, I live according to that word. I can't handle thinking about tomorrow next week to do what if. So that this hour, walk with him this hour. And life will be okay. That's about it.
Amazing. I don't want to lock anybody out. Is there? I think we're just about to conclude. Martin, you say something. You want to ask a question?
Just wanted to do something. You have the Bibles. Philippians. Philippians chapter 4, verse 11 to 13. Philippians, yes. Philippians 4, 11 to 13. Someone who's there can take it up.
11 to 13.
Philippians 4, 11 to 13.
Mommy. 11 to 13.
11 to 13.
I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through him who gives me strength.
Contentment. Single and contented. Single and contented. Now, even as we talk about this as singles, like she said, there's something she said, I'm getting her name.
Rose.
Yes. Some of us here have been in relationships, right?
Some are.
Yeah?
Some still are.
Some are in relationships, right? There are some that the situation, that me, convinced it is not yet, what did you say, Fred? Does not have, the opportunity has not yet come. The question that we ask is this. Are we content with who we are as persons? Are we content? Are you content as a person? Are you content with where you are at? Are you content in God? Because one thing that I keep learning, especially as believers, there's this thing that I call Christianese. I don't know how many have heard of the Christianese language, where there's so much talk about spirituality and things of the spirit and what, yet within us there is such, we live lives that do not show forth the fruit of what we are believing in. And it's very easy to be in church, listen to the word, walk away, do whatever you are doing, but at the end of the day, your belief system has not captured really what the understanding of who being a Christian is. Now, when Paul is talking here, learning about contentment, there are some times when the situations, things that present themselves in our lives, put us at a place where we start asking questions. For example, someone who's in a relationship and the other one is not, and probably they've been there for quite some time, you start asking yourself, why is it that there is the other person? Why is this happening for this other person and not happening to me? You are in a relationship and the relationship breaks, and you start asking questions of, why does it happen to me? And the question is, whenever we are surrounded or we are caught up with the things that happen to us, where is the position of our heart in the place where God stands? Because what you realize is that unless you are content in God, all these other things cannot stand. As a single man, let me speak for myself. I've realized to seek fulfillment in a relationship is failure. If you are pursuing fulfillment in the things, because the things that we do are part of what help us in life, but they are not the thing. God is the one who holds us. And so if we do not find contentment in God, that lack of contentment will be passed down to the people we relate with, whether you are in a relationship, whether you are at work, or whatever happens. And so the question becomes, are we contented as believers? Are we contented as individuals? Are we contented with what God has called us to be? Do we understand the calling of living a Christian life? And if we understand it, yes, how does it reflect in our lives? Knowing that there are times when we may fall away, there are times when things will happen in our lives that will pull us away from that. But how do we go back? Because for me, that forms a very serious point of approach in my life. Because when I know I am content, Paul says, in all things I have learned to be content in God. Because there is the place where he says, he gives us the power, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So it means the strength comes from who? Christ. The strength comes from God himself. And so that is the question that as believers, I feel we should always ask ourselves, in the things that I am doing or the things that I am pursuing, where is my contentment level with God? If it doesn't work, do I give up on God? If it doesn't go through, where does it leave me as a person? Yes, as I finish, I was once in a relationship. And then, you know the way you can invest in something? Because it was your first love. Let's break it. Let's break this thing down. Yes. First love issues. And sometimes the first love thing comes, you love without thought. You love because you feel like, yes, this is the thing. And at some point, the relationship became an idol. where I lifted it to the extent that now worship God and the relationship. I would do things to keep the relationship going, not the relationship with God, but the relationship with this other person. So by the time this relationship was coming to an end, I had invested so much of myself that I couldn't believe it was ending. Now, it took me time to get back. And after that, after we broke up, God revealed a lot of emptiness within me. In that I was finding fulfillment in another person rather than finding fulfillment in God who brings this other person to me. So that is the question that I ask. As somebody who knows the Lord and loves the Lord, are you sure about your relationship with God in such a way that if something happens, you will still stand? Romans says, after you've done everything to stand, you stand. And that is the thing that we need, like believers, like people who are single. Are you content single before you seek a relationship with any other thing? Are you content? In who? In God.
There's something. Let me read for us a verse, very popular. I think some of us have it on their mugs. So it's Romans 8:28. Yeah, it says, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. Yeah, and we always stop there. Okay. But the verse 29 says, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. To be conformed to the image of his son. That's the good that the previous verse is talking about. Because the whole goal of being a Christian is to be conformed to the image of Jesus. And that's what should be our pursuit as Christian. That's what we should be longing for. Because in either way, whether you are married or whether you are single, that should be your goal. Even when people come together as married people, they come together to help each other to still pursue this thing, you know, being changed in the image of Christ. And so I know the culture kind of paint marriage as this happy ending of the movie, yeah, but as Christian, I think this is what we should be looking for. Like, this is the race that was marked out for us. That's what Hebrews say. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that we need to pursue Christ and, yeah, try to be more like him. It's hard. It's not easy. But I always look at it as a spiral. Do you guys know what a spiral is? Mm-hmm. Yes. You are up today, tomorrow you fall, but you're still moving ahead. That's how it works. Yeah. Today you will be like filled with the Spirit, but again, we are flesh and blood, and we fall. But what picks us up is just that Christ has done everything. He died for us, and he's so merciful. And you come back to the Father, and he will welcome you. And then you go up again, and you keep moving, until the end of your life. Because our journey on this earth, the sanctification will take your whole life. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Your whole life you will be struggling, coming up and down, up and down. Still moving ahead. So, yeah, that's my encouragement for us. And let's keep moving.
Yeah, thank you, Jeremy. Even as we conclude, let me just say, living as a Christian today is hard. It is really hard. I will not lie to you. That thing is hard. Christianity is hard. Nguvan, huh? Yeah, and let me just stand up and say, come on, Ezalala. I might fall off the stool. But it is hard when we desire to do these things by ourselves.
Yes.
When we want to hold on to this thing and say that I am the pilot of this thing and I want to maneuver this thing by myself. It is hard. I remember before I got born again. I just got born again when I was very old. An old guy, like 7 years ago. And, you can imagine, nilikuwa naangalia 30 pale, third floor, and hapo ndo unaenda na sijiokoka. And then I got born again, and I remember I got born again on 14th of Feb. It was a Valentine's Day, and I said, yeah, I want to fall in love with Jesus. Amen? Even I also some gay people. And I was just waiting for this preacher to make the altar call, and I'm like, manzeni patei na fasi. I fall in love with this guy called Jesus. And before he was like, hey, I'm here. And I thought maybe it would be like five of us. And then niko peke yangu in a very big chunk. And then, hey, yes, that one hand, come. I said, hey, like, makofi yao jama. And I'm like, oh my God, niko peke yangu hapa. I got prayed for and I got born again. And I had told myself, I had told God that God ilete me itaokoka mimi. Wachana na ama hypocrites, wanakoka nanafanya na vitu. I will say truth. This journey, I will show them how people walk. You know, before that, I was a very strong persecutor of the church. And I remember there's a church in a disintegrated Koiga chapel, and they didn't have a place to meet. And I met with a guy called Raman. Kambiona yon yemefanyika, yon do revival. Yani, I was so happy that he can say mevunjika. Mnajifanya uko. Mmekuja hapa kwenye sisi tuko. Sijeni tukunywa hii kitu. God, mimi nikiokoka mimi nitakuwa kama kina Rama and so forth. Rama just laughed at me, and you know he was a very good friend of mine. Even with all this insult, he still continued being my friend. He's still a friend to date. Alikuwa anaimba Rongai Chapel hapa before. Sijisikiza anaimba hapa. But when I got born again and 6 months, 7 months, this thing is good. None of the nation, this thing is supposed to be sure. This is the way you are supposed to do this life. I'm good. Yani, mimi ni ka church mouse. Hapa Rongai, a church called New Life. I'm always there every lunch hour, evening prayers, morning prayers. I'm there. And the pastors are like, hey, ukijana amehoka, and he's doing it really nicely. Wacha mapigo zikuje bana. And then I went back to campus, and for like 2 years, I wasn't born again. I cannot tell you. Sezo danganya. Mimi salvation kuna naisikia. Tunaenda church. Naimba praise and worship team, niko hapo naimba. Tanuni nimeenda kwangu, nimetulia. Mimi maisha narudi kawaida. And I lived that life for 2 years. And church, it's because today's church is really looking for converts. And the church is no longer looking for disciples. We don't have the desire of making disciples. We are out there to make converts. We want our churches to be big, to be mega churches. And by the way, it is very easy to ask a man of God, how many congregants do you have? Na atakwambia, I have 500. Atakwambia 450. He'll always go to the highest, to the next zero. Yeah, 500. On the, how many children quest? 200 or so. Season 110. Because you want a mega church, you want a bigger church, you want converts, but you are not discipling them. The church is running on empty. And so many people in church have that thorn in the flesh. And I can tell you, everybody has a last name. And what I'm saying is that everybody has a last name. You have that thing that is always pulling you away from God. And the most obvious and default reaction to sin is hiding. When God comes to the Garden of Eden and says, Adam, where are you? And Adam, I had you coming, you can decide to be here. That's what happens to us as Christians, that any time that we hit that wall and we feel so embarrassed about ourselves and we find we want to go and hide, and the devil wanna capitalize on that, and he wants to hit us with guilt. When you come to church and Mato is there saying, lift up your holy hands, you want to lift up, and then, hey, these are not holy. Not holy, bana. You are saying holy apa. Don't even talk about holy, because we feel so bad about ourselves. At times you come to church and you feel mimi ni nanuka. It's stinking. Even people in the worship team, I'm not saying our worship team does that, but we've engaged over the weekend and Sunday to do practice Saturday, and the worship leader is expecting us to come and back. But upon it, we're friction because we know we are not clear with our conscience. Tunapigana. People even switch off the microphone. The man at one listen is gonna switch. Don't switch off. I feel myself, I cannot sing for this God the way I am. So the best thing is to switch off and you open your mouth, kabisa. So we have the problem with the sound guys. We cannot hear you.
And that's what sin does to us. It tries to detach us from God. And people, I can say for sure, it is not easy to live this thing by ourselves. And it comes to that point of dependability on God. Just coming to that point of saying that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It is not about me. I remember sometime back when we were still at chapel, we used to say this thing every time before we start our service, as the service is team, and we could say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And we would say something like, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can! And then we highlight every word until it makes sense for all of us that it's through the power of Christ. And how do we invite the power of Christ in us? It's through prayer. And hey, for me, I came to realize that the Devoran is your kuomba wakati amenigonga na kasimu. Amenigonga hivi and I'm there. My father and my God. Mwoni nani tayo nimeita. He reminds you immediately. What are you saying? Huh? Stop it. Okay. Sawa, nimesikia. And you feel you're so unworthy to call on a holy God. And it's true. We are all very unworthy to call on this holy, three times holy God. And there's a pastor at chapel who likes quoting a scripture in Isaiah, and he says, woe is me that I have seen God and see the daddy. And he doesn't even say woe. He says, woe! I've seen God and I'm still alive. And it's a three-time holy God. Holy, holy, holy. And our sin, by the way, it detaches us from God. But the righteousness of Christ covers us. It is not about ourselves. God calls, somebody said here about filthy rags, and it's true. Our filthiness, man. God looks at us and sees filth. and filth. And I like how Pastor Oscar puts it. Do you know what filth is? Filth. This sounds toxic. You know what filth is? Filth. It's like a monster rug that we use during those particular days. A menstrual rug. That's who I am before God. And that's what God sees me. A filthy, filthy rag. I'm filthy. But the righteousness of Christ. When God looks at me, he doesn't see me first. He sees the righteousness of Christ and he says, "And yeah, my son." He calls me son. And I like posting sometime before. I used to post this thing every now and then before. But I was still very new in salvation. So that I could get so many likes. No. A very powerful word that the Son of God became the Son of Man, so that the Son of Man can become the Son of God. And some likes, first time it was 50, 2 weeks later, atuma tena, likes zimepungua 30, 20. The next time it was 2, I'm not posting that thing again. But guys, it is true that the Son of God became the Son of Man, so that the Son of Man can become the Son of God. And it is true, it is very easy to live this life if you don't depend on God. It's very hard to stay on course. And I want to urge us that let us look at the true north. And the true north is God. He is the true north. If we're in that, we are living in an Amazon kind of setup, right? Where the world is moving so fast, the technology, imekimbia and all that. You try to serve something kwa phone yako and kidogo unapata, kuna kadema hapa kama sijui aje. Then it tells you click there. Before you even know, this thing has become pornography, and they're like, oh my God, Jesus. Hey, yani, there are so many adverts on the internet, and at times they might digress you to places that how could you expect, and because you have a curious mind, you want to find out how hot is this call. It and choma kiasi gani, you want to go that direction. And by the time you realize, umeenda, umeenda, ukirudi hivi, ni gildi na kurudisha. You have a neck that is drooping neck, because you don't want to look at people and tunapata na mato and staki kumambia sasa, because mato is a combination of Holy Ghost, you know, misbehave. But that's the thing. The thing is, even with this life being so hard and even us being in a position whereby it becomes difficult to practice our Christianity, nifananishe na the early church. When Jesus went and he ascended into heaven, he left some disciples who were unschooled, unskilled, and these are fishmongers. And
wamechukiwa kwa society and they don't know how to navigate this life. They are lost, they don't know how to stay on course, and they go and hide in a room in Jerusalem, and they stay there waiting for the Spirit of God to come, but also again hiding. But the Spirit of God comes and falls on them, and Peter, this guy who had denied Jesus, who had warmed himself and became a minority among people who were Jesus' enemies, he stands out after being filled by the Holy Ghost, and he says, "Manze, this guy that you crucified, he died, yes, true, but he's resurrected and he ascended into heaven." And that day the Bible says that 3,000 people, more than 3,000 men, came to the faith. Women not counted, because you know where women were being kept at that particular age in life. I don't know how, whether they counted women, but they say 3,000 men came to Christ. And you know what wowed them is how this guy was speaking, and like, wow, these people are speaking our language. We can hear ourselves from these people. What does that tell us? That we can relate with people in a way that they can understand what you are professing, and they like it, and they're like, wow, napendo yo God wa Freddy. Wow, yo God wa iPhone. Nampenda. And not because of the things that God gives me, but because of whom God is making me to be. And I can never say napenda God, oh your boy. I don't profess that faith, but the way that guy is living his life, I love that God. If he's serving that God, I want to serve that God as well. And instead of us going and saying that I don't know this Jesus, we come to a point of people saying, wow, we can see ourselves in these people. Because if you're speaking my language, then I can see myself in you. And I want to serve this God. I want to be part of what you're doing, part of who you are. And part, I want to be a son. I want to be a daughter of this Most High God. Yani, let us read the scripture and the book of Acts 20:24 and Hebrews 12:1-2, even as we conclude. Asomarakaraka for the interest of time. Acts 24, it says, in my mark here, 24, kumbe nikuwa ni maisoma. It says, however, I consider my life with nothing. I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. And Hebrews says, that was Acts 20:24, and Hebrews 1-2 says, nani ako hapo? Mimi kama nifika mbele yenu wapendwa. Hebrews 12:1-2. Nasema, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, akopile mso wa cloud, umesikia nimekupata, unikomenda kwa minority kwa Tanzania. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. And that's my encouragement for you this day. I've just read from 1 to 3. I was supposed to read from 1 to 2, but imeni shika sana mpaka nika nikaenda hiyo side nyingine. So I just said that everybody and everyone here has a last name, and we all know what we battle with. And there's some sins in church that even probably tumezi. How have you done that? We've respected them. They are called respectable sin. We call selfish ambition. Ah, that young man, he's very ambitious. But this guy is very greedy. He just wants everything for himself, and we sugarcoat it and call it very ambitious. And so it's not a matter of maybe at those big sins that we think about, maybe sexual sins and all that. But the small things that entangle us, and as you take that to know, let us just know that to overcome this thing, we just need to depend on God every day. And how do we depend on God? We just need to fix our eyes on him. Philippians 3 from verse 12 to 14, I'll read. You know, pastors conclude very many times, even as we conclude. Let me just read this and then we leave. Philippians 3 verse 12 to 14, that it says, now that I have already obtained all this,
for I've already arrived at my goal. But I press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Amen? Amen. I think that is my encouragement for all of us this day. Let us forget about what has happened upon the land. Let us press towards the mark of the higher calling in Jesus. And it doesn't mean that when we fall, we have lost our salvation. No. It just means it's a reminder that we need God every day more than we ever needed Him. More than we thought we ever needed. Ushefanya kitu kafikiri hiyo battle nimeiweza. And then as you forge forward na maringo na kiburi baka, unaambia pastor hapa vijana wana sin sana, that day ndio sin yako inakugonga na kumka wao. My Jesus, come this thing is still here. It's because at times we might lose that consciousness that we are depending on Christ and we start depending on ourselves and we go wayward. But staying on course and marching towards the mark of higher calling, just looking at Jesus. Gazing at Jesus and looking at him. I like Peter. Peter is a very good Christian. He's a born and bred Christian, eh? Where he tells Jesus, if it's you, tell me to come. And that's what we did when we came to faith. He told Jesus, if it's you dead on the cross because of our sins, let us come to you. And we walk. We don't know how long or how far Peter walked, but we are told that he walked on water until he removed his eyes from Jesus. Nakangalia happened around him. And he drowned. But the good thing with Peter, he did not try to swim. He called on Jesus because he needs Jesus who had called him. And he told Jesus, help me. And Jesus pulled him out. Even for us as Christians, at times we walk this journey, na tunaangalia mawimbi, tunaangalia hizi vitu zinafanyika hapa. Eh, natamani hiyo. You know, at times I've ever seen people do things paka nasema God kama singekuwa nimeokoka, wow. Hiyo mimi ningefanya hiyo. Hiyo ningekuwa ndani kabisa. But the mark of the higher calling, it's yani I just want to fix my eyes on Jesus. Regardless of these waves inanipiga piga hapa, I still want to stay on course. And even for us, let us not feel bad about how hard it is for us to walk this journey. But let us remember that it is hard if we try to do it by ourselves. Let us surrender our will, our passions, our desires, everything to Jesus. There's a writer who wrote and said that throwing in the towel for a Christian does not mean that it's defeat. It means victory at last. That God, I'm in a place of despair. Mimi nimeshindwa hii kitu, I cannot. That's when Jesus comes and says, yeah, umeshindwa, it is true. But it's me who's doing this thing in you and through you. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to just come here and share our lives as Christians. God, we know it is indeed very hard to do this thing by ourselves. And Father God, we are praying for your dependence, oh God. That Father, you will impact our lives and you'll walk with us, you'll carry us, oh God, in places that God we feel weary, oh God. In places that God we want to find God will come through for us and just equip us once more and just fill us with your spirit, oh God. Father, we desire how the early church did their lives, oh God, depending on the Holy Spirit. In the book of Acts, we see so many areas where the disciples depended on the Holy Spirit, oh God. And that's what we want to do, oh God, because by ourselves we cannot, oh God. We've tried it, oh God, and Father, we have failed. But Jesus, we want to thank you because Jesus, we've tried you and we found you to be worthy. And we want to walk this journey, pressing on to the mark of higher calling. Stay on course, staying on your path, oh God, staying on your will, oh God, and doing your will. And God, we are honest to say that, God, this thing at Uwezi kufanya bila wewe, we cannot do it by ourselves. And God, we need you more than we thought we've ever needed you. We need you more than yesterday. We need you more than even hizo siku zingine, God. Because God, we desire just to come towards you and press towards you, oh God. Father, even as we depart from this place, oh God, we pray that God for your impactation, oh God, and that God, you may be able to impact the world through your power, oh God, and be a true representative of who you are in us, oh God. May people desire to serve our God, who is you, who reigns everlasting to everlasting. And Father, we want to draw our identity from you, acknowledging that God, you are our Father. More than any other thing, you are our Father and you are our God. And God, our dependence is on you, O God. Father, we want to surrender to your will, we want to surrender to your purpose for the glory and honor of your holy name. For this we pray, believe and trust you in Jesus' name.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Santeni sana kwa kunisikiza na santeni sana kwa kuja. I hope uko juu umemaliza. And by the way, if anyone of us here who hasn't come to the faith and they receive Jesus and feel anya, I need somebody to pray with me. You can come to Jeremy, Marty, or myself, and we pray together. Yeah, maybe you feel you have received Jesus and heart to pray with someone. Just come here and we will pray with you. Have a very good week and may God bless you so much.